KC is a 79-year-old man presenting to the emergency room with chest pain radiating to his left jaw. His wife Jane tells the admitting nurse that earlier that morning, he had become short of breath. He felt nauseous and lightheaded before collapsing to the floor. You see, KC was observing a yearly time change enacted by US law, daylight saving time, where everyone in the country would set their clock forward 1 hour at 2 a.m. the second Sunday in March. Officially, the reason to do this is to save energy and boost the economy by increasing the number of daylight hours during spring and summer seasons, but Casey's case is part of a building body of evidence. This time change can negatively affect human health. Immediately after setting his clock an hour forward, Casey felt disoriented. He had done this before for the last 45 years of his life, so there's nothing different on this Sunday in March. He did have trouble sleeping that weekend because of the time change, although he didn't think too much of it. But the next day on Monday morning, just before breakfast, Casey suddenly felt his jaw become stiff. His chest tightened instantly. He gripped the armrest of his chair because every breath he tried to take was a struggle. He didn't want to tell his son downstairs because he thought that it would frighten the grandkids. He didn't want to tell his wife because he thought she'd overreact. He didn't think this was a big deal. At lunchtime, Casey tried to lay down because he thought he could sleep this off. But 20 minutes later, he vomited 3 times with no relief. Casey couldn't take it anymore. He could barely breathe anymore. His wife found him collapsed on the floor as she called for 911, and he's brought to the emergency room, where we are now. Given this history of present illness, there's a few clues as to what's happening. Chest pain with shortness of breath could be a problem of the lungs, but it could also be a problem of the heart. Casey had a prior history of diabetes and asthma, which could be the main problem here, but there's definitely more. The medical team immediately draws some of Casey's blood. They hook him up to an ECG. Proteins and enzymes from his heart muscle were found floating around in his blood, and the ECG confirmed the medical team's suspicions. Casey is having an ST elevation, myocardial infarction. Myo, meaning muscle. Cardia, from ancient Greek, referring to the heart. Infarction, from Latin, farcir, meaning to stuff into, and more modernly, meaning a blockage of blood flow causing cell death. Death of heart muscle due to a blockage of blood flow, and ST elevation, referring to the ECG reading that he has a specific change in the electricity of his heart, meaning that he's having a heart attack, which brings us to the next clue. KC told the medical team that he was a type 2 diabetic. This means that his body's cells are resistant to insulin. This is a hormone that your body releases after you eat. Insulin enables the shift of those nutrients you just ate into the cells, like sugar. When the body doesn't respond to insulin anymore, blood sugars stay high because they're not going into the cells. But also, the body starts putting out wrong signals because it thinks that insulin isn't being released, so it asks for more. The body thinks that it's starving and starts metabolizing fat stores into the bloodstream. As these fats float around, some of them get transported into the liver to make cholesterol, all of this causing hyperlipidemia. Hyper, meaning high. Lipid, referring to fats, and emia, meaning presence in blood. High fat presence in blood. This means these blood fats will start pooling in the vessels that supply blood to the heart, called the coronary arteries. The heart is a large muscle. Big muscles are very oxygen hungry, so they need a lot of it to function. Blocking the coronary arteries will starve the heart of oxygen and cause parts of it to die. And in KC, parts of his heart were starting to die, which brings us back to the name ST elevation, myocardial infarction. KC was at an increased risk of heart attack to begin with. At 79 years old, his heart has degraded over time because of normal wear and tear. No one at 80 has the same heart that they did when they were 20. But KC's heart also degraded more because his diabetes means that his body's metabolism can't get his blood sugars right, his body can't get his blood fats right, and his body can't signal right with the correct hormones. Fats start to pool into his arteries. This causes the smooth muscle lining inside those arteries to die. But it's not done here. White blood cells rush into the site because they detect damage. They start to engulf the dead cells of the artery wall, but they also engulf the fats. And as more fats keep accumulating, these white blood cells start to die too. Smooth muscle cells start to make collagen and proteins to cover up this dead necrotic core. This fibrous cap seals the area and the plaque formation is complete. But while this plaque can cause a heart attack by itself, it isn't always an ST elevation heart attack. ST elevation means a full blockage, meaning that whatever is there isn't just fat. But what else could it be? It would have to be something that's already in the blood. It could be more fat, but probably not likely since this is so sudden. It's not sugar because that's probably not going to clump up in solution. But speaking of clumping up, how about a blood clot? This additional blockage can happen suddenly. It can block the whole thing. It can cause immediate changes in an ECG reading that changes over minutes as heart muscle keeps dying from the lack of oxygen. Without fresh blood flowing in, waste products from cells begin to accumulate. The heart tries to compensate, but as each minute passes by, parts of Casey's heart keep dying. But why would this blood clot form? Clots usually form when you get a cut, like on your skin. So did he get a cut inside of his coronary artery? How would that even happen? Well, the plaque is made of cholesterols and white blood cells that died when they engulfed too much fat. The plaque is inflamed. Inflammation is what happens, like when you get a cut. Diabetes puts someone in a pro-inflammatory state. The immune system expands the blood vessels so more fluid can flow in and more immune cells can enter the area. The thing is, the chemicals released by the immune cells during inflammation in and around the plaque break down that fibrous cap. The plaque ruptures. Other blood cells think that the vessel wall is injured like a cut and they start clumping there. This completely blocks the artery very quickly, causing Casey's sudden heart attack. So that's the how of Casey's heart attack. But why did it happen? And what does daylight saving time have to do with it? Well, it actually might have a lot to do with it. This brings us to a concept called the circadian rhythm. This refers to our body's natural clock. Science suggests that the human circadian rhythms are based around sunlight. So this directly ties our internal clocks with sleep. This is why it's harder to take a nap in the morning if you've been sleeping well the past few nights. It's why many people feel gross after pulling all-nighters and waking up at nighttime when it's dark outside. And the sunlight hypothesis is why we think computer screens, which mimic daylight, keeps us up at night and disrupts sleep. There are differences between people in terms of their biological clock. Some are morning people, some are night owls, but the overwhelming majority of people show differences in the activity inside of their bodies at different times of the day. In human experiments, we found that sleep deprivation increases inflammation. The average sleep duration in Western societies has decreased from 9 hours to 7.5 over the last 100 years, and it looks like it's still decreasing. In that same experiment, scientists found that depriving someone of sleep impairs their insulin sensitivity and glucose tolerance. More evidence from decades worth of studies show that night shift workers, that's people who work overnights, do have a higher chance of developing diabetes and cardiovascular disease over years if they keep working those tough shifts due to increased inflammation, decreased insulin sensitivity, and impaired glucose tolerance. All three of these were already a problem in KC because he had diabetes, but there's more. Daylight saving time has been shown to disrupt human circadian seasonal adjustment. On the second Sunday in March, most of the United States sets their clock forward 1 hour. This date sits about a week and a half from the Northern Hemisphere spring equinox. Right around this time, sunrise and sunset widen dramatically, which means our bodies are already adapting to seasonal change. But when an arbitrary 1 hour shift happens, it forces yet an additional change on our bodies. This extra disruption in circadian rhythm significantly changes which genes are expressed in our body. It inflicts signal changes disrupting sleep, increasing inflammation, decreasing insulin sensitivity, causing a cascade of metabolic derangements. Some of the data shows there is an increased incidence of heart attack in the days following the 1 hour forward adjustment, in line with the scientific reason for why it happens. Young people can tolerate these changes, but elderly with pre-existing conditions likely cannot handle this, which brings us back to KC. As each minute passes, his chances of dying from a heart attack increase. He's immediately sent in to the hospital's cath lab. This is a place where doctors can use imaging equipment to see arteries and chambers of his heart. They send a small wire through a blood vessel in his wrist to reach his heart. They find the blood vessel that's completely blocked. A balloon is placed on the wire, and through the blockage, it's inflated. popping the blood vessel open. A mesh called a stent is placed in to help keep that artery open. The stent also releases medicine that helps prevent scar tissue from forming at that site. This process is called percutaneous coronary intervention, PCI, and it's part of something called reperfusion therapy, meaning that it helps get blood flowing back into the heart again. So, cases like Casey's bring up a lot of different issues. Data shows an increase in heart attacks in the days right after the 1 hour forward. A letter to the editor in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2008 wrote that in Sweden, from 1987 to 2006, the incidence of all heart attacks increased in spring daylight saving time, mainly in the first 3 days after the time change and continuing for the week. Interestingly enough, during the autumn time change, where we go backwards 1 hour to normal time, incidence of heart attack decreased in the days afterwards. So okay, that's Sweden. Their daylight saving time is later in March compared to the United States. They're in a different part of the world, on a different latitude. What about American data? Well, the published data is a little bit more limited. It's mostly focused on Michigan, and they do show that there is an increase in heart attacks in the immediate days following daylight savings time. So, the evidence that it happens is there. The scientific rationale that it happens is there. Going an hour forward just before the spring disturbs sleep quantity and sleep quality in humans. Altering the circadian rhythm leads to an increased activity of the sympathetic nervous system, which directly affects the heart. Metabolic derangements that mimic type 2 diabetes happen during this change, along with increased inflammation. For people at risk of developing heart attacks in the first place, all of these disruptions can be the straw that breaks that camel's back and be that final blockage in the coronary artery causing a heart attack. Casey was allowed to rest after his PCI. Days later, he was discharged. Having an ST elevation myocardial infarction puts his 30-day risk of dying between 2 to 3%. His chances of presenting to the emergency room again in the next 30 days is maximum 25%, but not missing his doses of his medicine and trying to control his diabetes helped him be in that 97% that don't die after a successfully treated heart attack, and it helped him be in that 75% of patients who aren't rehospitalized. So, the point of this video is to tell you how a specific type of heart attack happens. If you're young and healthy, you probably don't have a coronary plaque. It's not just getting enough sleep, it's getting the right kind of sleep. Slow wave sleep happens hours after sunset, between 10 p.m. and 1 a.m. You might miss out on this part if you go to sleep late, and you might miss out on the growth hormone that's usually released during this time as dictated by the circadian clock. Over years, if you don't sleep well, you don't eat well, and you don't exercise, and you smoke, these are gonna add up. Human hearts deteriorate over time no matter what, but it's in your control as to how quick that decline happens based on your habits and behaviors for the most part. No matter what, that 1 hour forward is throwing off hundreds of millions of people with what looks like a minimal benefit, with only harm for patients like KC. Every year, there's a lot more people that are entering in that 65 and up demographic because of the baby boomer generation. These are the ones who are going to get hit the hardest by this. I would prefer that we stay on standard time all year from a health standpoint. With care from the medical team, diligence in keeping up with his medicines, and staying on top of his diabetes control, KC was able to make a recovery. And thanks so much to my good friend, cardiologist, and YouTuber, Dr. Rohan Francis, for reviewing this video. Thank you so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.